Hey folks, Dagan here from PMTVUK and welcome to another episode of DGN. Dagan's Guitar News here on the PMT House of Rock YouTube channel. A weekly news roundup show where we chat about all the awesome new gear that's landed this past week, new releases and what's happening in the world that's rocking and rolling around us. Here's what's coming up this week. Now this is going to be quite a lengthy episode because loads has happened in the world of music. My personal favourite being the fact that PMTVUK have been away in California for the past 2 weeks. Myself, Meg from the channel and Alex and Drew, who are the folk for PMTVUK that you don't see on camera, we've been away in California checking out some of our favourite brands, so off the bat, I've got to say hit subscribe down below to be the first to see all this amazing content coming from the US of A. We'll go to ESP, Taylor, Schecter, we'll chat to the legendary pedal designer that's George Trips, we check out PRS, go to Dunlop, and so much more. I'm probably forgetting some crazy stuff. We go to the Sunset Strip and do a piece there. We've got vlogs from Venice Beach where we talk about the Doors. It's absolutely mental, so yeah. I'm excited for that. I'm excited to share it with you guys as well. I know Meg is and Alex and Drew are as well. So hit subscribe to be the first to see that very, very soon. I just want to get that out the way first. Now, loads of awesome new gear has landed recently in the guitar world. We're a very lucky bunch. And the ones we'll be talking about today in this week's episode is first off the Gibson Theodore, which is a new model for Gibson from their archive collection. But it's not necessarily a new model because it was originally sketched out in 1957 by none other than Ted McCarty. Line 6 have released the Mark II DL4, their iconic delay pedal, but a Mark II slightly updated version with some HX goodness in it. With staying with delays, Boss have the RE2 and the RE202, which are modern-day space echoes. These were kind of, not teased, they were accidentally released on eBay a few weeks ago, but now we have definitive proof, because they're there, the RE2 and the RE202 space echoes and lovely little boxes of joy. Kramer have the new SM-1H, a single pickup Stagemaster. Fender have the Player Plus Meteoras, and they're absolutely crackers to look at and to play. And none other than Mr. Blues Power himself, Jared James Nichols, has released a little Blackstar Fly Blues Power edition. It's kick-ass. Because there's so much to talk about in this episode, I'm not going to be able to cover everything, so please comment down below anything you want to add on anything I'm talking about in this episode or things that I've missed just to share the love amongst folk, okay? Now, new music that's landed. Skid Row have announced a new singer and a new single and a new album on the way. And Mark Tremonti has released, I think it's fantastic, he's released a Frank Sinatra cover album and it's absolutely unbelievable. You know Mark Tremonti from the band Tremonti, Alter Bridge. The guy's metal as hell, but he has some beautiful pipes on him and he's a big Sinatra fan and there's a lot more to go with that as well. It's absolutely fantastic. And finally, the fact that Wolfgang Van Halen has released some details on the mystery guitar he's been playing. He's been playing a very peculiar Wolfgang and he's released some more details on it and I'm chuffed to bits. Right, anyways, let's get talking first about the beautiful, beautiful, in my opinion, Gibson Theodore. Now this guitar with its beautiful little reverse Florentine cutaways up top is a design that was sketched by Ted McCarty back in 1957. And this is a time when, before they were doing the double cuts, and the Les Paul Junior double cuts and those kind of things. So this is kind of pre that, maybe he was designing the double cut with this, but it kind of got lost in time. It wasn't until Gibson are now doing a great thing and they're delving deep into their past, like you can see on the Generation Series acoustics with the cutaway hole, with the sound hole at the top here. That came from an old drawing from back in the 60s. So now they're kind of delving back into the past, and the fact that they've called it the Archive Collection means that there's hopefully some more very unique, weird and wonderful guitars coming from Gibson's past. So the Theodore. It's called the Theodore after Ted McCarty. Now Ted McCarty was the president of Gibson back in the day and he's responsible for such guitars as... Oh, what are they called again? Oh yeah, the SG, the Les Paul, the Firebird, the Explorer, the Flying V. His guitar designs are just simply iconic. And this guitar never made it back in the day. I'm not really sure why, but I believe they were going through trying to find some old lap steel stuff from the 40s through these old archival, really old, I don't know, as if I was there, I don't know. But yeah, they found them and they recreated it for the modern era. It's made of alder, which is very, very cool. The body, anyways, for Gibson. And with a beautiful walnut stripe down the middle. Two P90s, a wraparound tailpiece. It is a custom shop. Hopefully they'll bring out a USA version, because I definitely want a USA version of this guitar. It's fantastic. It doesn't deviate too far away from Ted McCarty's original drawing. I think there's mini humbuckers in his drawing, but the P90s in the model now. They moved the pickup switch and stuff. Mahogany neck, 57 chunky C-shaped profile, and it's got a big old Explorer headstock. It's just a weird and wonderful guitar from the late 50s, and I'm absolutely here for it. The senior director of product development at Gibson, Matt Kohler, said that it was like unearthing King Tut's tomb when they found all this stuff, so hopefully there's some more awesome designs coming in the future from Gibson. But first, I want a USA version of the Theodore, because I will buy it in an absolute heartbeat. It's absolutely awesome. Let me know what you think about the Theodore down below in the comments. Joe Bonamassa has an amazing video talking about it. Trogley's Guitar Show on YouTube totally dissects it, and they take it to bits and they find the long neck tenon and all the beautiful guitar nerd goodies. I think it's a great little blast from the past, and I don't know, when you see brands like Gibson trying to make new stuff and trying to reinvent the wheel when they've already got such a stronghold on the classic guitar, like they're synonymous with old school guitar building, classic designs. When they try and push the boat out, some people hate that, like modern Gibsons and stuff. So this is a great way for them to get new guitar designs, but bringing stuff back to life which never made it back in the day. And Ted McCarty was a smart guy, and I reckon there's loads more guitars hidden away, and I can't wait to see the rest of them. But yeah, let me know what you think down below in the comments. Next up, Line 6 have launched the DL4 Mark II. Now, touching on what I was saying earlier about the fact that we were chatting to George Trips, which was amazing for me over in California. I remember being a kid and getting my first Way Huge pedal designed by George Trips, because he's an absolute madman when it comes to pedals, vintage fuzzers and crybabies and stuff. I had the chance to talk to him and interview him and stuff, and he was the chief designer of the DL4. So it's cool that now they've got a new one, and even though it's not Line 6 anymore. Anyways, DL4 crack is awesome, and it's an iconic pedal. That original DL4 pretty much started a whole new genre of music, with the amazing kind of, they do simple delays, but also some of the most amazing delays you've ever heard. That green pedal is just simply iconic, and now Line 6 have revamped it by cross-pollinating it with some of their HX wizardry. So the HX Stomp, the Helix, the LT, and all that kind of jazz. They've kind of put 15 new delay sounds, as well as the 15 legacy DL4 sounds, in this little box and just kind of zhuzhed it up for 2022. I'm of the crowd which believe that the DL4 is one of the most important pedals of, well, the past 20 years, because it came out in 1999, so it's 23 years from today. It's very important. So the fact that they've added to it and haven't changed it too much is kind of crucial for me. They just kind of made it easy to use. All the controls are very similar on the top. It's in a little rugged design. They've added time onto the looper, so it's 240 seconds in mono and 120 in stereo, which can be extended if you put an SD card in the back. You can do a lot with this little box of joy. You can get all the iconic DL4s, but again, with the funky new reverb, well, funky new reverb-y, echoey delay sounds from the HX range, which you'll find in the Helix and all the rest of the HX goodies. And again, get yourself subscribed to PMTVUK here on YouTube to be the first to see our little review of the DL4. Don't know whether I'm going to do it or Sam's going to do it, but whoever does it is going to sound fantastic, because the DL4s absolutely kick ass, and this Mark II is just going to kind of take it to the next level. Sticking with delays, Boss, new Space Echoes, the RE2 and the RE202. Like I said in the little intro bit, the RE2 was leaked on eBay. Someone tried to sell a little Space Echo on eBay, and there's some really shoddy pictures of someone like crouching over it, taking a picture, and everyone was like, what? They're releasing a Space Echo in a tiny little box. If you don't know what a Space Echo is, the RE201 came out in 1974, I think, and it was the definitive quirky delay, tape delay. It was a big, awesome box of wonder, and it's on so many iconic records over the years. I think only 500 were made originally, and they're like hen's teeth to find now. If you find them, they're hopefully in still working order, but they'll be very, very expensive if they are still in working order. But now, they did do the Space Echo previously on the bigger little dual foot switch pedal, but the way Boss are working now, they've kind of trimmed everything down and they've streamlined their entire thing. So now there's two variants, the RE2, which is your standard Boss compact pedal, which is kind of all the controls you need to get that iconic Boss Space Echo tone, and the RE202, which is more similar to the bigger, not the original one, but the bigger lad. So you can't fit a full tape, like a tape for a tape echo, in these little pedals, but you can replicate them digitally with lots of wizardry from the mad scientists at Boss. I think the RE202 is my favorite though. The compact pedals are very convenient, but the 202 just expands on the old RE20, and it looks like the 201, but small and on the floor. So you can, these pedals are known for their beautiful kind of flutter, or wow and flutter it's called, which is what happens when an actual tape ages on an old school delay, because that's how we used to get delay back in the day, by repeating it onto a tape, like an Echoplex and stuff, or original Space Echo. They had this beautiful kind of modulation, this warm kind of loveliness behind it. Again, stay subscribed to find out some videos in the future of me playing them or sound playing them. But I'm really giddy about this pedal. You can change between the 12 different modes, between the different heads of the repeatant head things, whatever they're called. But yeah, it's fantastic. The RE2 and the RE202 are back and are back. The RE201 is back in the form of these two wonderful pedals. Yeah. Now let's talk about guitars. This is a new Player Plus Meteora, and the fantastic Sam, who I keep mentioning in this video, has already got a full review of this fantastic guitar here on the channel, and the bass. There's a new Player Plus Meteora guitar and a Meteora bass, both with humbuckers, so check out his full review. This is just a little quick overview of these fantastic guitars. So in 2018, the Meteora was released, and it's a funky new modern shape by Fender. It's fantastic, and the Player Plus range have also just been kind of released last year, which is the next level up of their Mexican guitars. So they are the classic guitars with some funky little features. So like locking tuners, these have fireball pickups, fireball humbuckers on the guitar and the bass, and these snazzy new colors. There's an S1 switch you can coil tap, these humbuckers, alder body, maple neck. You can get a pow ferro or maple fingerboard. You can take the tag off as well if you want. But yeah, they look kick-ass, they sound kick-ass, and they play kick-ass. You've got a tremolo as well, so it's a nice little cross-pollination of Strat style 2-point tremolo, humbuckers. Yeah, it's gorgeous. These all came around because of Fender's Parallel Universe series, which was released a few years ago, and everyone kind of were really drawn to the Meteora, so that's why they're now in the lineup. Other fun little modern features: rolled fingerboard edges, 22 medium jumbo frets, big old rolled steel block saddles. Even though it's a modern guitar, it is still classic. It looks kind of got, it's got a bit of a retro vibe. You can get it in regular colors, but I like these fades. At the minute, I think they suit these kind of guitars. Really, really cool, but you can get sunbursts and the rest. They're all linked in the description box below. Everything I talk about in this video, besides the links to other videos, is in the description box down below, so you can check them out at pmtonline.co.uk. But yeah, this has been released, and I think it's kick-ass. The Meteora Player Plus. Is that even focusing? It might be, it might not be. Anyways, it's gorgeous. Check it out. So that was one of Simon's favorite guitars. This is one of my new favorite guitars. This is a Kramer SM-1H, the Stagemaster one with a humbucker. So the Stagemaster was the staple guitar. No, it wasn't the staple guitar. It was the creme de la creme of Kramers back in the day. They got the Berettas and the Pacers. This was the fancy, expensive one with all the nice little accoutrements, but that had three pickups. You can still get a regular Stagemaster with three pickups in, a humbucker in the bridge, and two either stacked Seymour Duncans or EMGs. This is the stripped back, sexy, almost like it's this and a Beretta ran into each other really, really quickly, and this came out the bottom end. There's a full review of this by myself here at PMTVUK. Hopefully you can see it in the background, where you watch me for like 12 minutes absolutely fall in love with this beautiful purple beast. These kind of hot-rodded 80s guitars are mostly associated with bolt-on necks on a, I don't know, alder or maple body. These are neck-through. Stagemasters have always been neck-through, that's why they're kind of top tier. So it's a mahogany neck, K-speed, Kramer profile, all the way through, and two mahogany wings on the side. It's a classic kind of double cut design, but it's contoured and arched in such a wonderful way, and you can get to that 24th fret, so a full 2-octave range, no problem at all. Beautiful thing. Ebony fingerboard as well, 12.6 inch radius, so it's lovely and flat when you want to get your 80 shred on, and it comes in a plethora of beautiful colours. This is shockwave purple, there's silver, there's buzzsaw gold. Let me know what your favourite is down below in the comments. You can series parallel the single pickup as well to get some single coil-esque tones, and the Floyd is totally floating if you want to get your Dimebag Darrell squeal on. Now the video of me reviewing this guitar has been up for a couple of days now when I'm filming this, and people are kicking off, well not kicking off, but like, why would you have one pickup in a guitar? That's not very versatile. Like I said, you can get the multiple pickup version, but this is quintessentially 80s, which in my opinion is the best time for rock and metal music. It was the time where music was the funnest it's ever been, in my humble Geordie opinion. And single pickup guitars do just sound that little bit better. I know Jimmy Page sounds great with his dual pickups, Steve Ray Vaughan sounded fantastic with three pickups, but when there's only one pickup, that's the only pickup that's grabbing the vibration of the strings. Even when there's more than one pickup, even if the pickups aren't even activated, the magnets are still pulling on the strings. When there's only one pickup, you get the purest sound of that string going into that one pickup, and it sounds fantastic. Let me know what you think. And last but certainly not least when it comes to gear, this is the new Blackstar Fly 3 JJN edition. Mr. Blues Power himself, Jared James Nichols, now has a lovely little signature Blackstar Fly 3. I've used the Blackstar Fly 3 in the house for years. Years and years. It's a fantastic little battery-powered box, which you can plug into the mains as well. It's one of the best-sounding little portable amps on the planet. And they'd love to do limited editions. Like, there's Def Leppard editions, there's Misfits, and now Jared has his own limited edition, which is decked out kind of like his big signature JJN 20 amps. So you've got the kind of green on the outside, the nice orangey, what's it called, the tweedy, or that colour on the front. You've got the lightning bolt, you've got BPMF down at the bottom, which stands for Blues Power Mother. There's not a gain switch on the top, there's a clean channel and a blues power mode, which is the gain channel. Gain control, EQ, which is the Blackstar's patented ISF, which means you can get it to sound more British sounding, more American sounding, kind of changes where the mid sits. There's a volume and a built-in digital tape echo, so you get that lovely kind of warm delay all built into this little box. You can use it with headphones, you can plug in your phone and play along with backing tracks. They really are absolutely awesome, and now Jared has his own lovely signature version. I'm actually chatting to Jared about this tomorrow, so when you watch this, it's already probably happened. But yeah, there's going to be a full review on the channel about this. Chatting with Jared, playing it a little bit. It's awesome. Now next up, let's talk about new music and one of my all-time favourite bands, Skid Row. I love Skid Row, it's right up my street, and they've just released an awesome new single which harkens back to classic Skid Row that I just adore. Now, no matter who's singing for Skid Row, whether it be Seb back in the day, ZP, or, well, I was going to say or, they've just revealed a brand new singer and a brand new single, and it's blowing everyone's minds. So the start of this past week, Eric Gronwall, I think that's how you pronounce your last name, sorry mate if you ever watch this, has just been unveiled as the new singer for Skid Row, and there's a brand new single and a brand new album on the way called The Gang's All Here. This is the first album from Skid Row since 2006's Revolutions Per Minute, and I can't bloody wait. Eric's one hell of a singer, you might recognise him from Heat, as well as another couple of amazing bands over the years. Yeah, new single, I'll link it in the description box down below, and the song itself is, it harkens back to that awesome time that is the 80s. Snake Sabo was one of my favourite guitar players of all time. I remember being a kid trying to learn his stuff. I can barely play it now, but blows my mind with that beautiful Dennis Klein Kramer. Dennis Klein has just passed away today, actually, when I'm thinking this right now. The guy that painted all the original Kramers back in the day for Mick Mars, Nikki Sixx, George Lynch, and Snake Sabo. So RIP Dennis Klein. But yeah, it's just awesome. So Rachel Boland, the bass player, and Snake Sabo said this about it. We are beyond excited to release this record. It's been a long time in the making, and a lot of hard work has been put in by the band and our producer, Nick Rasculinez. And the addition of Eric has lifted the songs to new heights. Add all this to the fact that we start our world tour in Las Vegas with the Scorpions residency this Saturday at Zappos Theatre, which is the day I think this video comes out to the world, so have a great show tonight, Skid Row. Make it easy to say that Skid Row is going to have a great year. So please, ladies and gentlemen, if you care about music and you care about PMTVUK, check out Skid Row's new single, The Gang's All Here, and or pre-order their new album, The Gang's All Here, which is coming out on October 14th. So it's a little bit of a wait, but hopefully they kind of drip feed the songs throughout the year. It's kick-ass and there's some great guitar playing on it. Next up, we have an awesome bit of news for multiple reasons. Mark Tremonti is releasing a Frank Sinatra covers album. Mark Tremonti is one of the most heavy-ass riffing guitar players on the entire planet, but the guy's got some pipes, and he adores Frank Sinatra. So I'm excited to hear him. There's a version of I've Got You Under My Skin already on YouTube. I'll link it down below. It's bloody fantastic. He nails the crooner's kind of swing, because if you're a good singer, you can sing songs, obviously, like Sinatra and stuff, but you need to have that laid-back kind of approach to it and work with the beat, either be slightly before or slightly behind. You just kind of got to smooth yourself into Sinatra songs, and Mark absolutely nails it. But not only is this album great because Sinatra is awesome and so is Mark, but it's getting released, it's a charity album inspired by Mark's daughter Stella, who was born last year with Down syndrome. And this album was actually created in partnership with the NDSS, which is the National Down Syndrome Society, which help individuals with Down syndrome and their families. And the album's gonna be released through a charity initiative created by Tremonti called Take a Chance for Charity, and proceeds from the album will be going straight to the NDSS. This cause is very close to Mark Tremonti, and I assume some of you watching this video as well. Here's what Mark had to say. For years, I've loved singing along to Frank's songs. One night, I found an old video of him performing The Song Is You from 1944. It made me want to dive into his vocal approach. I was all in, and I wanted to do something with it. When we found out about our daughter Stella's Down syndrome diagnosis, the stars aligned. My obsession with Sinatra had its reason. Frank Sinatra raised more than $1 billion for charity, and that's a big fact I wish the public knew more about. Beneath his cool and calm persona, he had a big heart. Just like you, Mark. Just like you, mate. Doing this charity in his name was another way the stars aligned. I decided to do this record to raise funds for families and individuals with Down syndrome. This project is the start of a new purpose that I will have for the rest of my life. There's 14 tracks on the album. It's getting released. When's it getting released? May 27th. And he faithfully recreates these famous crooner songs. He's got an amazing voice. It's just a great record. Let me know what you think down below in the comments. I love it when metal musicians do something a bit off-piste almost. I'm a big believer in the fact that no matter what music you listen to, like purely, like I'm an 80s rock and roll guy, I love it. But if you expand your knowledge, that'll help you musically. So if you're a metal guitar player, learn some jazz stuff, learn some blues stuff, learn some crooner Sinatra stuff. And you might not play it necessarily as your main thing, but it will help expand your knowledge and learn how music works in so many different aspects. So I think this is absolutely great. It's more than just a Tremonti cover album as well. Tremonti got in contact with one of Sinatra's old music directors and actually got people who played with Sinatra on this album as well. And it's already been highly regarded by already Kirk Hammett / they all think it's fantastic, and I can't wait to hear it. It's gonna be mint. Now, last but certainly not least on this week's episode of DGN, we have more details from Wolfgang Van Halen on that EVH Wolfgang semi hollow body guitar that he's been playing on tour with Dirty Honey headlining in the US of A. Talking to Chris Shiflett from the Foo Fighters, he expanded on this guitar. Now, Wolfgang has played EVH Wolfgangs in the past, but he's been seen a lot with the ES-335, a 1959 reissue, because he enjoys the way the semi-hollow body sound, because they're fantastic. And it was teased on Instagram. Obviously, the crash test phase, when a new guitar comes out, you have to tour with it, and everyone kind of lost their minds because there wasn't any information on this guitar, but now he's expanded on what it is. He loves the feel and vibe of a hollow body, but it's a Wolfgang. And it's called the SA-126. SA stands for semi-acoustic, and 126 is his dad's birthday. My Lord and Savior, Mr. Edward Van Halen. It's called that because Eddie had a song, well, Van Halen had a song called 316, 316 or 316, whatever you want to call it, and that's Wolfgang's birthday. It's March 16th, because America, you put the month first and the date second, unlike the UK, where it's the day first and the month second. So the SA-126 is January 26, 1-26, honouring his dad after he had 316 for that song. Everyone's been asking him, why don't you develop your own guitar? You're an EVH guitar, Wolfgang. I've been doing this the whole time. We're developing the guitar and I'm very excited about it. I'm calling it the SA-126. Dad's birthday is January 26th. He named a song 316 after my birthday. SA means semi-acoustic. That's been the code name, and the more I've sat with it, the more I really like it. It has one F hole, but we've modified it, so it's an E hole for dad. Casually saying dad, it's blooming Edward Van Halen. I'm really stoked about it. I think people are really going to dig it when they see it. He was very tight-lipped about the guitar, all the rest of the specs and all that kind of jazz, any kind of release dates. It is in the pre-prototype phase at the minute, I'm guessing. But yeah, his love for semi-hollow bodies. When we started recording the album, the first guitar that was like, oh wow, this is starting to become my own thing, was when he pulled his dad's 1959 ES-335 out. But apparently when he tried to tune it and stuff, the tuning pedal just disintegrated in his fingers because it's a 1959 ES-335, and he's been using the reissue on tour, and this is a nice little thing in the middle. He has been asked why doesn't he just play an EVH Wolfgang on tour, but he is just trying to carve his own path in the world. He has played Wolfgangs in the past, and they are fantastic guitars, but he's trying to do his own thing, and yeah, I think this is a little bit more information on a guitar that I really, really can't wait to see. It's blown my mind the first time I saw it, and every time I see it on Wolf's Instagram right now, he continues to do so. That's some more information, but let me know what you think down below in the comments about this and everything I've spoke about on this really long episode of DGN. I hope you've enjoyed it. I want to know your thoughts, and like I said at the start, anything else you want to add, please feel free to. Hit subscribe if you enjoyed it, and give it a thumbs up, and I will see you guys next week. Have a good one.